So we did two, things before publishing this out. One thing is that we tried overexpressing. By that time, Foxl-Millet transformation system was not available. One of our RAs, Dr. Priyanka Sood, her paper was published last January. But till then, we didn't have a stable transformation system in Foxl-Millet. So we had to do all our experiments preliminarily in yeast and then move to rice. So in yeast, we tried overexpressing this SHSP27 gene, and you could see that this transgenic cells overexpressing SHSP27 showed enhanced tolerance to heat, salt, and dehydration stresses. And now, although we published it with this data, then Roshan took it up for his PhD, and what he did is like he tried overexpressing this gene in the rice. You could see, although the data is very preliminary, because this part will be covered in detail by Dr. Manoj Prasad in his next part of the talk. You could see that transgenic clients are showing tolerance as compared to this wild type when the irrigation was withdrawn. So in addition to that, he also observed that the transgenic lines showed improved agronomic traits, including height, tiller number, panicle number, size, number of seeds per panicle, etc., etc. So by this way, what we did is like when we established I'm not going into these details. We established an integrated pipeline for gene family analysis, and we identified several such candidate genes from that 584 genes which were annotated as response to water. And we are now raising, or now we are functionally characterizing each of these genes. And very recently, like it is in May, we also studied the C4 photosynthetic genes in foxtail millet and its wild relative, Setaria viridis. And we have published that in this Journal of Biotechnology. So now what it did is our analysis has opened an avenue for further research in foxtail millet for characterizing each of the candidate genes. There are several reports now available where people are showing that our genes, they promote tolerance to salt. In one nice study published in Frontiers in Plant Science, they have shown that a gene promotes, or the gene confers drought recovery even after withholding the water, even after withholding this irrigation for 20 days. So such things were like, there in the foxtail millet genome, and we tried to unlock that potential. And then we realized that many of these genes which were annotated as response to water by Zhang et al. Were transcription factors. So we thought like, why shouldn't we identify all the transcription factors encoded in foxtail millet genome? So we developed an integrated pipeline. Then we identified 2,000 plus genes belonging to 55 different transcription factor families. And then we didn't stop there. We kept that in a foxtail millet transcription factor database, and we kept it open for the global research community to access and use the data further. On the other hand, one of my seniors, she also studied the microRNA part. Now we have moved very advanced. Like now we are studying all the small RNAs, all the long non-coding RNAs. We are even studying how each of the genes respond to particular stress. But these are like, very preliminary things which we did, which stands as a base for any further studies by us and by the global research community. And in one such study, we were the first to report dehydration responsive miRNAs in foxtail millet, and that was published in Planta. Then we have also constructed a foxtail millet microRNA database, and we put all the data in the database. So by this way, whatever we did, or whatever I did during my PhD, or whatever my seniors did during their tenure, we never kept anything to ourselves. We put it on an open access database, and we kept it open for the researchers to access and use these resources. And by this way, it has helped several researchers to work on genes, work on microRNAs, work on markers which we have identified. And we are now getting several papers coming out from different laboratories around the globe, studying different aspects of Foxtel Millet. Even very interesting studies are being published in the line of using Foxtel Millet as a feed also. As in the feed, they are trying to use Foxtel Millet as a replacement to oats, where they have shown that few of our genes which we have identified before are playing role in enhancing the biomass or the digestibility is also. So this is the thing. Like, I mean, in 2013 when we started, there were only few markers and few genes were characterized, and the crop was remaining neglected in terms of research. And with the year, what we did, we added several markers and we characterized several genes and gene families. And whatever we did, we put it in open access databases and we kept it open for the global research community. By this way, we transformed a neglected and underutilized crop into a crop with rich genetic and genomic resources. And we didn't stop then also. Like, I mean, several of our students, both at NIPGR and University of Hyderabad, we are working on each of these genes, and we are also using these markers to look into different traits. Like, say, for example, in millets, there is a big issue of rancidity. Millet flours won't stay on shelf for more than 7 days because it goes rapidly rancid. So we are also working on that aspect. And millet has appropriate amount of anti-nutrients, like, for example, phytic acid. So we are also working in such aspects to develop low phytic acid lines. And we are also looking into, in progress, better qualities or better traits of Foxtel millet into other cultivated millets as well as rice through both breeding and transgene based approaches. That is what that is how the things are progressing. But the stone was laid by us, onto which a huge building is being constructed. And as you could see, with the year, we made this progress, tremendous progress. In the year 2014 alone, we published 13 papers on Foxtel millet from a single lab. And that is how we worked on this crop. And I think I can stop here by showing you, like, I mean, after that, we also wrote an article where we showed, like, I mean, how this information can be used to develop or to improve or to develop such genetic and genomic resources in other neglected crop species. And we were also the first to organize a national conference on neglected and underutilized crop species for food, nutrition, energy, and environment last year, August 2nd, at National Institute of Land Genome Research. Dr. Manoj Prasad was the convener and I was the co-convener, where we brought all the research community who are working on such underutilized crop species to NIPGR. And we had several brainstorming sessions, talks, poster presentations, and we tried, you know, working on this further. We had Dr. Renu Swarup from DBT and Dr. Mohapatra from ICAR. They both also assured that the funding agencies will also work out on how to promote these underutilized and neglected crop species, because these species hold the potential for addressing this hunger and malnutrition. So in that direction, we are working forward. And with this, I complete my talk and I can address the questions, if any.
Thank you for your talk. As you say, is that it's a first part, and we are expecting Manoj sir giving the more details and more about your lab work.
Exactly.
And I'm request to you to if you because we are waiting for the answers and it's coming through. There is a box, it's Q&A. If you see it, then there is a 2-3 questions. Can you go for it? And I'm collecting few answers from the YouTube, if it is suitable and exactly for your talk. Have you got the Q&A box?
Yeah, Q&A box is there.
Yes.
Okay, definition of markers. That is previously it was like a 2-mark question, but now it has become broad. Once we were saying that these won't code for anything, now when SNPs or functional markers came into picture, the definition changed. There is a dynamic definition for markers which changes from time to time. As of now, how we say is like, I mean, this is a genomic region which regulates a particular trait. So that is what, like, broadly we can define a marker. Say, for example, these SNPs, right? It can do wonders. So those are, now we have moved to SNPs. Previously, SNPs was not in the picture because we were not able to sequence the genome. That was limitation in funding, et cetera, et cetera. So this definition changes with respect to even markers. If we are using SSR, the definition is different. If you are using SNPs, the definition is different. DDRED sequencing. Yeah, usually what we do is, maybe you should be having a little knowledge on Illumina sequencing to understand this DDRED. In Illumina, what we do, we isolate the DNA, we fragment it or we shatter it, then we ligate the adapters, and then we go for sequencing. In DDRED, what we do is like, I mean, we use restriction enzymes. One is a frequent cutter and one is a rare cutter. So frequent cutter and rare cutter, as you know, restriction enzymes cuts at a specific part, I mean, at a defined sequence, like a TAACC, something like that. So if it cuts there, it will be easy for us to ligate the adapter, and then we can go for sequencing. So by this way, we were able to enhance the coverage using this DDRED sequencing. It is the definition itself is like, I mean, double digest restriction associated DNA sequencing. Double digest means we have to use two different restriction enzymes to digest the DNA and then go for regular sequencing. We have oxygen germ plasm of different colors. Does color has some specific advantages in terms of quality, like Ragi? Yeah, like, I mean, one of our MSc student is working on this. She is trying to see whether the color has something to do with the content of the millet, and now we don't have much data on it. Once it comes, maybe we can discuss on this actually. How secondary cell wall related with stress tolerance? Secondary cell wall we studied because that time, foxtail millet is closely related to this biofuel crops. So few groups which were working on this biofuel traits, they said that can we look into some genes which has role in secondary cell wall lignin biosynthesis, etc., etc., so that they can use that information in their crop. Because two groups, one is working on switchgrass and the other one on Napier grass, it was their request. Then we went on to look into the genes encoding for the secondary cell wall biosynthesis genes, and that is how that paper came up. Linkage drag will change the efficiency of marker assisted selection. We didn't go up to that point where we never went to the field, because to be frank, in NABJ there was no experimental field where we were able to do this kind of field level experiments. So we didn't go up to the level of marker assisted selection. Once we go there, then only we will be able to understand how much this linkage drag has impact on this efficiency of mass. Why finger millet is not used common for cooking as rice? This is a very interesting question. Like, I mean, people nowadays are asking like, why we are not using millet in the place of rice? Because several millets are very bad in taste, to be frank. You have to put little more effort to cook it properly or cook it in a tasty way. Other one is rice has that the taste of rice cannot be replaced, right? Although barnyard millet, you people would have heard of, there is one restaurant in Gurgaon, I forgot the name, there you will get barnyard millet biryani. So now people are like, I mean, coming up, or people are moving towards millets. But as I said, one thing is popularity, it is lacking, because only a marginal population is consuming these millets. Even people, if I see, I developed my own interest on why I wanted to see what is there in the literature. So we had a tie-up with one PhD student who was from Department of Tamil, and that fellow went and searched the Tamil literatures, and he came up with a statement that millet was there before rice in Tamil civilizations. Because in many of the songs which were written that time, he is mounting the inscriptions of millets than rice. So it was there once on our plates, and slowly we moved to rice maybe. And now few people are coming back to millets, but mostly what is happening is like we have deviated towards oats. People prefer oats more than millets. So yeah, that is also an issue. But slowly the awareness is coming up. Slowly the people are developing protocols. Even recipes are coming up. So we have to wait and see how much millets can gain on the plates, gain space on the plates. ILPs are intron length polymorphic markers. It was once very famous because before this SNBs came into the picture, because in the introns there are polymorphic regions, and we developed primers flanking those introns, and we were using those. That was very much useful in several of our genetic diversity studies, but now it is more of outdated one. Resistance genes from foxtail millet can be transferred to rice. We have to see whether what we can do in this regard. It's a long way to go. Good markers for finger millet. Now finger millet genome is available, so you can easily jump in and identify genomoid markers. If the genome sequence is available in SRI database, take it out and put it in MISA, you will get thousands of SSRs. If two cultivars were sequenced, I believe that different cultivars of finger millet has been sequenced at least in transcriptome levels. If that is so, you can align the reads of different cultivars to identify SNPs, and of course these SNPs will be gene-based SNPs. So these SNPs have more value than the genomic SNPs, so you can go for it. Only thing is you have to have a little bit of knowledge in this NGS thing. Will your team be doing research to identify genes of oxygen millet that is responsible for its yield? Yeah, we have identified several genes and we are working on it. Since the data is in very preliminary stage, I have not shown it. We are on it. Production and productivity of small millets is low. How can we promote to cultivate these crops? Production and productivity is low because it has not been in the mainstream research. If research would have been done, then production would have, or productivity would have been enhanced. Say for example, if you get any chance to travel to Madurai, the southern part of Tamil Nadu, there is an agriculture center there. If you go there, they have released a variety of banyard millet called MDU. You won't believe me, people or farmers who were cultivating rice in that Madurai region are now shifting to banyard millet because that is giving them more reward. So very few group are actually working on this yield or productivity parameters. And that is why we are not having good varieties which has more yield. So before promoting, maybe we should work little more on enhancing its traits. Is it possible to cross foxtail with finger millet? Foxtail millet with finger millet, I don't know whether it is possible to cross because we have not tried that, number one. And finger millet itself is, pearl millet, sorry. Pearl millet itself is a hardy crop. I confused with the before question actually. So for crossing foxtail with pearl millet. Pearl millet itself is a hardy crop. So transferring any gene from foxtail millet to pearl, I don't think it makes relevance because I think both are equally good in terms of performance and climate resilient traits actually. What are the profitable millets for farmers in UP? You have to see. In that case, what we try to advise people is you have to go to the nearest agricultural university where they will be having such data, and they can clearly guide you, and they can even give you seeds which you can use for cultivation. So it should be dependent on your climatic conditions, soil, rainfall, etc., etc. So such institutes or universities can help you in this regard. There is CRISPR tool rather than molecular markers to create gene-targeted crops. What about your stand? The purpose is totally different. Markers is to identify genes. CRISPR is to manipulate the genes. So can we create CRISPR bioactivate millets to silent transited genes? Yes, we are using that approach. We will see how much success we got sooner or later. What is C4-PANICA model for analyzing stress responsive gene? So far, among the C4-PANICA, foxtail millet genome is out, pearl millet genome is out, finger millet genome is out, sorghum genome is out, maize genome is out. These five crops are to an extent climate resilient or stress tolerant. So you can study the genomes of all these five crops to identify what these crops have gained and what the other crops have lost. Certain studies use promoter sequences of oxygen millet for transgenic studies, especially for organ specific expression. What makes the promoter sequence of foxtail millets important? I have not seen I have not come across any such studies where they have actually used promoter sequences of oxygen millet in transgenics. So if I could see that, then I can answer. Otherwise, I don't know. Yeah.